Amen. Amen. Why don't you stand with me as we pray, please? Let us pray. Father God, we thank you for your grace and your mercy, Father. Father, John 15:13 says, greater love has no one than this, that one laid down his life for his friends. And that is what so many have done. They've given their lives for their country and the freedom and values we hold so close. Father God, let us pray and remember those men and women who have made the ultimate sacrifice and have died in war. Those we remember today died for a purpose. Amen. Father God, it was to provide freedom and hope to those that had none. Father, let us be reminded that our very freedom is a product of their sacrifice. Father, I pray for our country and our leaders. Father, I pray that they remain steadfast in upholding our values and laws, Father. Father, on this Memorial Day, we pray for peace in the United States, Father. We pray for peace in Israel, Father. We pray for peace in the world, Father. Father, I pray for peace and a coming together of our country. I say this in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Well, good morning. It's great to see you in the house of the Lord this morning. I want to especially welcome our first-time visitors. It's great to see you. I know we've been praying for you. If you're a first-time visitor of ours, we ask that you fill out a welcome card. It's in the seat back in front of you. At the end of the service, our pastor would love the opportunity to meet you, greet you, put a free gift in your hands. But at this time, our members and regular attenders would like to meet you. The way we do that around here is we ask you to stay seated. Members, regular attenders, let's get from where you are and greet those that are new.
Singing, yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord, amen.
I am blessed but not cursed, persecuted, not abandoned.
Struck down but not destroyed.
I am blessed beyond the curse, for his promise will endure. His joy is gonna be my strength. And though the sorrow may last for the night, his joy comes in the morning. I'm trading my sorrows. I'm trading my shame. I'm laying them down for the joy of the Lord. I'm laying joy of the Lord.
Amen. If you would return to your seats and remain standing as we continue to worship the Lord this morning.
Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me.
Who the sun sets free. Oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am.
Free at last, he has ransomed me. His grace runs deep. I was a slave to sin. Jesus died for me.
Yes, he died for me.
Who the sun sets free.
Oh, it's free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me.
chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. Not forsaken, I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am. Oh, I am who you say I am. Yes, I am who you say I am. Who the sun sets free, oh, it's free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God, yes I am. In my Father's house, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God, yes I am.
Amen, amen, amen.
As I come into your presence, past the gates of praise, into your sanctuary, when we're standing face to face, I look upon your countenance, I see the fullness of your grace, I can only bow down and say, awesome in this place, mighty God. You are awesome in this place, Abba Father. You are worthy of all praise. To you our lives we raise. You are awesome in this place, mighty God.
As I come into your presence, past the gates of praise, into your sanctuary, till we're standing face to face, I look upon your countenance and the fullness of your grace. I can only bow down and say, you are awesome in this place, mighty God. You are awesome in this place, Abba Father. You are worthy of all praise. To you our lives we raise. You are awesome in this place, mighty God. You're awesome in this place, mighty God. You are awesome in this place, Abba Father. You are worthy of all praise. To you our lives we raise. You are awesome in this place, mighty God. Just sing that with us with the voices.
You are awesome in this place, mighty God. You are awesome in this place, Abba Father. You are worthy of all praise. To you our lives we raise. You are awesome in this place, mighty God.
Amen. Amen and amen. You may be seated. Good morning. Oh, come on. I said good morning. Hey, it's Sunday. It's fun day. Good to see you. We're continuing our message on prayer. The Lord's disciples have requested of Jesus, teach us to pray. Remember, the context of this passage is they have seen the impact already in the Lord's life that prayer made. And you know that carried with them everywhere they went, no matter what the situation was, Jesus was always taking time to be with the Father. They saw it in the Lord's actions, his attitudes, his presence, his power, you know, the miracles that were wrought after times of praying. So the disciples kind of caught on quickly that there's got to be a connection between these, all right, to discover the power of God. And there certainly is a connection in prayer. So if you want to have some, I think, real power in your life as a believer, there are disciplines that are part of the Christian life that so many people overlook because they don't like that word, all right, disciplines. But we are disciples. So if we are disciples, and there should be disciplines that go along with being a disciple of Christ. And those disciplines are not what make us right with God. It's what lets us enjoy our fellowship with God so that we understand him more carefully. But prayer is certainly one of the leading topics of the New Testament and the importance of prayer. You see it all through the scriptures, not only in the New Testament, but also in the Old Testament. But we're looking at this today. We talked a little bit about last week about this is not what we are to pray. He said this is how we pray. He didn't mean that we get up and recite this prayer. I know a lot of people do that. I'm not opposing doing that, all right? Praise the Lord that, you know, we recite scripture. It should be memorized, and it should be meditated upon. It should be said, should be sung, amen, any way we can. I have communication in the Word of God, participation. But this is really a model. It's a skeleton. You should take it apart and look at, you know, where the meat goes on it, you know, where the muscles go. Because Jesus said when you pray in this way. And it's a model. It's a way which he's instructing us. And I think there's so much here to be discovered. That's why we're not rushing through it. I mean, we talked about a little last week of what the introductions to that were, getting us ready to pray. Don't be like the hypocrites. Go to the inner room and then, and, you know, be humble and seeking the Lord's face. We dealt with that. We got into just a few phrases. But let's start by reading this passage again as we honor the Word of God. Would you stand with me? And we'll read the prayer portion of this passage. Last week we started with the introduction to it. He says, pray then in this way. Our Father who is in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Say this with me. For yours is the kingdom and the power. Let's do it with a little more authority, amen. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. That's a little better, all right. You may be seated. Remember last week we talked about just those first phrases where he says you pray like this. You know, there's basically six references to where he talks about our, you know. It's not just me that I'm praying about. Those were the first insights to discovering that prayer is not all about you alone, and we'll talk about that more in a moment. But he said it's our, we're participating. And when we pray, I think this is an introduction that we're praying to the Father, and this is corporate prayer. I really believe sometimes the church misses out on praying together and praying corporately, even though we encourage you to do that. And we have prayer meetings where we do that. But I think even in service, when someone is praying, that it's not just Gary or me or somebody else on stage leading in a prayer. You take the time as well to pray. It's our Father, and it obviously is telling us really who he is. Praise the Lord that we come into a relationship with God. If you're in a relationship with someone, you know, you see your little Facebook, in a relationship, you know, it means you're usually talking to somebody a lot. Well, he's our Father. We're in a relationship. We ought to be talking. There ought to be some communication, not just us speaking, but also hearing. So we talked about our Father. We talked about who he is, that family relationship is established, who art in heaven. We talked about that gives us a declaration that he is in rule over all things. He's the ruler of the universe. We're going to talk about that in a little bit more detail today, but it tells us where he is. And it's not just talking about a location. It's talking about a sovereign rule, all right? He's over all things. He's over the universe. He's God of all things. Our Father deals with the nearness aspect. In heaven tells us, you know, he's exalted. Amen? So it's our Father which art in heaven. Hallowed be thy name tells us what he is. It's saying we're serving a holy God. When it talks about hallowing, it means to understand that he's a holy God, that he's a unique God. There's none like him. As we said last week, there's none after him, none before him. He is the eternal God from beginning of all things. He has been there. He is the eternal I am. So the idea is that we're entering in with this attitude. We have a relationship established, and we're worshiping. The Bible says, enter his courts with thanksgiving and with praise. We should always start, I think the model's given us, to always begin our time by just, hey, before you get to your list, to really get to the pressing needs, let's take a moment and tell our Father how we love him. Let's communicate with him. Let's recognize his worth. Let's recognize his holiness, because that's who he is. He's God above all things, and he is a holy God. Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. So the first part of this has to do with the aspect of worship. The second part we're going to enter today has to do with intercession. All right? We entered in with worship, and now he moves to this next part where he says, your kingdom come in verse 10. Your kingdom come, I will be done. But let's focus on these three words, your kingdom. I mean, our greatest desire should be to see the Lord reigning as being over his kingdom, all right, where he has honor, where he has recognition and authority. Now, they've always been his, all right, but he has not yet come to the planet to claim them. He has come as Savior. He's come as the Lamb suffering. He's come as the risen Lord, but we understand there's coming a time and biblical prophecy reveals to us that the king is going to come and take rule over all the kingdom, all right? In fact, the king is inseparable from the kingdom. We are being called to live in the kingdom where we have a king over our kingdom. So to pray thy kingdom come is to pray ultimately the program of God is being carried out, that the eternal God's will be fulfilled. It's for Christ to reign over all things as the King of kings and the Lord of lords. I mean, so the idea is moving into prayer with intercession, I understand, I think this is what the Lord's trying to teach us, that his program, his will, his plan should be the preoccupation of our prayers and the preoccupation of our lives, that we understand that we're a part of an everlasting kingdom. Unfortunately, if you examine prayer many times, at least I'll be honest, most of it's concerned with our world. It can be a bit self-centered. We're focusing on our needs. We're focusing on our plans. We're focusing on our aspiration. We're focused pretty much on our understanding. But if we get real honest about it, that's kind of like a little infant kind of mentality. You know, it's that little baby who kind of realizes only in the little world they exist in that that's all the world there is. Our time, my plan, my feelings, how I think, what I want. One of the greatest struggles we have as Christians is to fight that when we enter into prayer. Not that God's not concerned about, you know, finding, you know, the plans, purposes, and needs met through him, but we got to get first things first, that it's God's will, that it's God's worth, it's God's plan, it's God's design. This old nature of mine, which has been dealt a death blow, but I have to take it to the cross daily, it has a tendency to want to get in the way. What do I want? What do I want God to do for me? How do I want God to perform? What do I think God ought to do on my behalf? And we really miss the mark when we start focusing our prayer life on ourselves. So at the very beginning of this model, the Lord's saying, let's pull this out of your mentality into a bigger picture here. You know, your kingdom come, not my kingdom. God's kingdom come, not my world. So the best we can really pray for anybody, if we're focusing on this, is that the cause of God's kingdom, that the will in God's kingdom be advanced in that person or whatever the cause may be we're praying about. That first and foremost, this is about the kingdom of God. The ultimate holy purpose of our divine Father is to exalt Christ Jesus in the consummation of history when he comes and reigns in his kingdom. You say, what do you mean? I mean, there's coming a day when Jesus will reign on this planet. All right? He's been here before, in case you didn't know. He provided a way for us to know him. But he also said in the context of all the gospel, part of the gospel message that is so often left off is that he's coming to rule as king again. Amen. And scriptures lay out the very clear biblical plan for the planet to come under the kingship of the king who rightfully owns it because he made it. Amen. And, the Lord said, you know, this should be a part of your prayer life, all right? The Talmud is saying if a prayer does not name the kingdom of God, it says it's not really prayer. Why? Because it puts the focus back on the will of God as he goes to the next part of this prayer and talks about thy will be done. But the idea is here that the kingdom is being advanced. The word kingdom here doesn't necessarily mean like a geographical, you know, the kingdom of this nation, the kingdom of America, the kingdom of Iraq, the Great Britain, whatever that kingdom might be in different parts of the world. It's not talking geographical. It's talking about a domain. It's talking about a sovereignty, all right? And this word, basileia, it deals with this idea that, you know, sovereign God rules over all things, all right? He is a God in heaven who will bring his kingdom to bear in the earth one day. Now, it's already started in our hearts and lives, all right? We're part of the kingdom of God. And so when we pray thy kingdom come, we're praying that, God, you would one day be enthroned and your glorious reign on the earth would begin. This was popular mindset in the first century church. They look forward to the kingdom. As time has passed, it's somehow been lost. You know, we look forward to an exciting day when Christ will appear and his kingdom will be established, that it will come. And he says, Lord, thy kingdom come. Let it happen is the idea here. The word come comes from aoritis active imperative of this ekomai, and it has to do with a sudden and instantaneous coming. Jesus described his coming like that in Matthew 27. He said, just as the lightning flashes from the east to the west, so will the coming of the Son of Man be. You ever seen lightning flash from one side to the other? Boom, boom, it's done. And he said, there's going to be a sudden, boom, instantaneous coming of this new kingdom. It's going to happen. Whether you understand the concept, whether you believe Bible prophecy or not, whether you believe the Bible is just another book of religion or you believe it's the Word, it doesn't matter where you stand on it. It's still going to happen. All right? Well, I don't know if I believe it. Sorry. It's still going to happen. People didn't believe Messiah would come the first time. He was prophesied hundreds and hundreds of years before he ever came. Went by. Time started tick-tock, 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 tick. And then all of a sudden, just like God said it would have, the Bible said in the fullness of time, he came. What's that mean? When God had it on his calendar. When appointment time. I have a dentist appointment, all right? I hate them. Not dentist. I love dentists, but I hate appointments, all right? With dentist, all right? I don't mind meeting them in the restaurant. I don't like meeting them in their office. They put their hand down to your mouth, your throat. I mean, who does that? You're sitting there just taking it. They're poking, prodding, drilling, scraping, whatever they might do. That's a miserable thing. All right. Where was I going with that? Somebody play that back. No, that's all right. The idea there's an appointment. It's going to happen. You might try to skip the dentist, but you're not going to skip this appointment. All right. You might bail out of that appointment, come sick or whatever you might think just to get out of it, but this kingdom is coming, and it is a literal kingdom. The book of Revelation talks about it. The book of Daniel talks about it. The Old Testament prophets talk about it. The New Testament scriptures talk about it. A day when this millennial reign of Christ will happen on the earth. It is a new day, and to pray your kingdom come is to pray that God's kingdom would literally be established on the earth in which he alone is the king. You're going to do away with all these dictators and all these presidents and all these congressmen. Hey, praise God and the Lamb. Can I get a bigger witness? We're going to have one true, honest king who is a righteous ruler of all the nations. And the Bible says that the nations will go up and worship him and recognize his kingship. Thy kingdom come. By the way, lest you not understand me, it is a kingdom that is on the earth in verse 10. It will not be a kingdom of this world or of this present world system. Jesus said, my kingdom is not of this world, but he's bringing it to this world. All right, and it's going to be established in this world. No human kingdom is going to dovetail into that kingdom. Now, why do you say that? Because there is a popular theology out there among a lot of preachers today, this kingdom dominion theology is what it's called. And it's an idea that you and I are going to establish the kingdom of God and get it ready. As we establish it and we get it fully in place, then he's going to come. No. All right? That's why a lot of people put a lot of energy and effort into social things, you know, and social justice and social activities and, you know, trying to always improve the culture. Now, we as Christians, I'm for that, amen? We ought to be salt and we ought to be light. But my focus is not upon those injustices. You know that Jesus, how he dealt with the injustices? He led people to salvation. All right? How do you deal with a racial issue? Get saved. Then you realize you're part of one holy race, God's family. All right? How do you deal with the issues of inequities and all the injustice? Get saved. God changes a man's mind. He changes a woman's heart. He changes their attitude and just gives them a whole new approach to living their life. So that's the kingdom that we're really focused on. Yes, we ought to be a part of things, and we ought to be seeking to deal with the injustice in our society, but that's not the main drum I beat. I beat the gospel drum. And in beating the gospel drum and raising up Christ and lifting and exalting Christ and his influence in the world, it's amazing how hearts are changed and lives are changed. But we're not, as Christians, going to somehow get into the social system of the world and get it all ready for Jesus to come. And kind of he just dovetails into this divine reign from our reign. Listen, no sinful man can be a part of the divine reign. It is unique. It is God, it's of God, it's all God. Yes, we can try to improve human society. I mean, the good, worthy causes that deserve the support of Christians, all right? And we ought to be supporting those things. But ultimately, it gets down to this. The only ultimate healing for the culture is going to come through Christ Jesus as the Lord and the King. And so we want to be bringing people to Christ Jesus. There's going to be a kingdom on earth, but we're in the process, not of trying to usher the kingdom in. We're just participating in God's work and will in our lives in his kingdom now. But that kingdom which we're participating in is going to fully come one day and be established. It's the kingdom of God, not the kingdom of men, not the kingdom of socialized men or whatever. It's the kingdom of God, all right? And this is what was the heart of Jesus' message. It says he came to preach the kingdom of God. A little later in the verse, he says, for I was sent for this purpose. Now, most people don't have that in their gospel, toolbox. Their gospel toolbox, they pull out, okay, all right, God loves you. God has a wonderful plan for your life. You're a sinner. Jesus died to save the lost. Okay, and you can repent and believe. And Jesus is coming again. That's in there too. And when he comes again, he's going to establish kingdom over the earth over all men. And he's going to redeem a fallen world. And he's going to wrap it all up, establish a new heaven and a new earth, and it's going to be an eternal kingdom. His earthly kingdom will dovetail into the eternal kingdom. His earthly kingdom, not mine, not yours. So the kingdom of God. Jesus says he came for this purpose. Well, what was his purpose? Well, he preached the message of salvation. What was it? How to get in the kingdom. How to be a part of God's family. He must preach the kingdom, for this was I was sent. Remember, for 40 days after the resurrection of Jesus Christ, for 40 days, Jesus ruled, he remained on the earth, you know, before his ascension, after the resurrection, and it says he spoke to his disciples concerning the things of the kingdom of God. He came back 40 days, and what did he do with the kingdom of God? Kingdom of God. He's teaching his disciples at the beginning of his ministry how to pray, thy kingdom come. This is what we're working for, guys. We're seeing a new kingdom. Now, God has always ruled, all right, as he does now, over the universe, all right? He created it. He controls it. He orders it. He holds it together. It'd fall apart if he did hold it together. He is the king over all things. And his kingdom, according to Scripture in Psalms 145 and in Psalms 103 and Psalms 29 and 1 Chronicles 29, among many, many, many other passages, His kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, all right? It knows no end. Ultimately, he, as sovereign over the kingdom, rules over all things. But it's obvious, if we pay attention around us, that God is not now ruling on the earth as he rules in heaven, all right? He's not here as the personality of as Jesus ruling the earth. And so it's this divine kingdom that we're praying will come. and that he will rule. So our praying, and this is where you kind of see where you're at in your prayer life. What part of our praying should be for Christ to return? Well, at least some of it. What part of our praying should is that we're asking God, please, Lord, establish your kingdom, put down sin, enforce the will of God, that your kingdom will rule as an everlasting kingdom on the earth as it is in heaven. That will happen, that you will come and you will reign. Listen, the early church knew this. I mean, look at what they're always talking through the scriptures about the coming of the Lord, the coming of the King. Be looking for the coming of the King. Blessed are those who are looking for the coming. There's going to come a day when we see the King. The common theme, or at least the common welcoming verse among Christians would be, Maranatha, which means what? Come quickly, Lord Jesus. So that when Christians talk to each other, it wasn't, hey, it's Maranatha. It wasn't, hi, what's up? Maranatha. Come quickly, Lord Jesus. That should be a part of our prayer life. The Greek word, we talk about that word ekamai, it literally means let your kingdom come now. Let it happen today. There's a sense I think we should be praying for God. Lord, please come today. Now, I've discovered the older I get, the more I pray that. Can I get a witness on that? Sometimes it's selfish. Well, most of the time. I'm ready for that new body for sure. I don't know about you. I'm ready for the presence of Jesus on the earth, but the day is coming. So let me give you some practical points, basically, how this works into our prayer life. This part of when he's saying, you pray like this, pray thy kingdom come. Practical point number one be, the kingdom comes this way, first of all, by conversion. Matthew 18, verse 1 through 4 says, at the time, disciples came to Jesus and said, who's the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? And he called a child himself and set him before them. He said, truly I say to you, unless you're converted and become like children, you will not enter the kingdom of heaven. Who then humbles himself as a child, he's the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. First of all, you have to be a part of the kingdom family. You have to come to know the Lord Jesus Christ. There's this act of conversion. It means to change. So we go to on these trips to overseas. We take these converters with us, all right? And the converter means that, like in Israel, they have like 220 outlets, all right? You plug your hair dryer into that, you're going to toast it, all right? It's gone. Anything you plug into, it's going to fry it. So you have a converter that takes that one, that 220 and breaks it down to 110 so you can plug your device into the converter. And it adapts it. Well, in reality, we have been converted. We've been made able to handle the power of God, all right? Listen, if it came in all at once, you couldn't handle it anyway. So, God's given us an ability to know him now. We can communicate on the same frequency because we've come to Jesus Christ. We have the Holy Spirit living in us. We have a new heart, a new mind, a new life, right? We have experienced conversion by the Holy Spirit of God who lives now in us. But the Bible says that's the way you come into the kingdom of God. You're going to be part, as a Christian, you're part of an everlasting kingdom. You're part of an eternal kingdom. And to get into that, you got to humble yourself and you have to become like this little child. We love to quote John 3:16, for God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son. But John 3:3, let's not pass this over. Jesus answered and said to them, truly I say to you, unless one is born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God. All right? And I think that's two ways. One, you're not going to get to experience. And two, you're not going to even understand it. There's something about a perceiving here as well as receiving. All right? You want to receive Jesus Christ and you're brought into his family and you're brought into the kingdom which he rules over. At the same time, now you're given the capacity to understand what's going on and to see what's happening. Jesus said at the chapter before this, Matthew 6 chapter, in chapter 5 verse 3, he says, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. So he's talking about this humble attitude, this surrendering like a child and accepting in faith. One thing about children, they have a greater potential for accepting things they don't completely understand. And if you're sitting there twisting your brain out trying to figure this all out, it ain't going to happen. The Bible says it's by faith we understand that the world was framed by the Word of God. All right, people are, well, how can you believe that? Because I believe the Word of God. And I believe it's the Word of God that framed everything to start with. I've made a decision to trust in the Lord. And the more that I choose by faith to trust God, I believe the more clarity he gives us and the more understanding and the more knowledge and information. That's what Paul said in the book of Ephesians. He says, I'm praying for you that the eyes of your understanding, that you'll be able to perceive and get the height, the depth, the length, the breadth of the riches you have in Christ Jesus. to see your place in the kingdom, amen, and to see what God has for you. So that if you want a practical point, we're praying that people come to experience Christ in their life. I mean, in a present and limited, real but miraculous way, God's kingdom is coming to the earth every time somebody's born again. There's a little more of the reign of Christ becomes present in the earth every time my life is under his reign. You got that? So every time someone you know comes to Christ, the kingdom's advanced a little bit more. The kingdom cause is working a little bit more. All right? So that new converts, new children of Christ, they're becoming new citizens in this kingdom. And they're coming to Christ. How's that work? Well, it starts with an invitation. The Bible says all who are thirsty, you know, if you're hungry, it's like the parable of the marriage feast when the Lord sent the disciples. Says, you go out, you compel them to come in from the highways and the byways and the hedges. Bring them in. So there's this invitation. That's part of our responsibility in the kingdom as a church on the earth today, is to be encouraging people to come in, to meet Christ, to know God. That's part of sharing our faith. That's part of inviting people to church. All that works in. If you have a kingdom mindset, you understand that. Nobody has to twist your arm anymore. You know, you're not an infant anymore. You've begun to understand that you have this call, that you're part of a greater thing than your own world. You're part of the kingdom. You're part of the will of God. You're part of the great purpose of God to establish kingdom. So we're intercessing here. We're praying, God, that you bring people into the kingdom. So the invitation goes in. Then repentance takes place. Jesus is like this little child. This child does what? He comes in faith. He leaves behind. He moves forward and makes a choice. The Bible says about John the Baptist that after he had been taken into custody in Mark 1, it says Jesus came into the Galilee preaching the good news, preaching the gospel, and saying, the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel. All right? The kingdom is at hand. The kingdom is still at hand, folks. It is nearer today than it was yesterday, but it's also available to anybody. They can enter into it now. He's going to reign over the earth. He already is reigning in many of your lives today. All right? You've kind of established a foothold already. But praying for the kingdom to come, in this sense, is praying for the salvation of souls, all right? Standing in the gap, as we call it. Praying for people who don't know Christ. So if I'm praying for kingdom, not only establish your kingdom on earth, but Lord, you know, there's people that even now can come to Christ, even now can be saved. We stand in the gap for those people. That's point number one. Point number two about understanding this kingdom, it comes not only through conversion, it comes through commitment, all right? While the kingdom of God is a coming event, it's also a present reality, all right? His kingdom should be manifest in my life today. There should be a commitment on my part that really says Jesus is Lord, all right? That really sheds that truth about my life, that when you look at somebody who says they're Christian, Christ is in control. He's the king. He's the boss. He's the president. He's in charge. I don't care how you say it. It all boils down to the same. Right? Yes, he's Savior, but he don't save until he gets on board as king. He comes on with what he does is saving because of who he is, and who he is he's the king. Understanding this mindset, and there, I believe there's an element of, should be of at least of excitement to realize that you're part of something bigger than yourself. If you ever go to some of these visionary kind of conferences about, you know, getting setting goals and visions and concepts and motivating people, and they always say the key to motivation. Let me boil it down to you because I listen to a lot of that. Said the key to getting people on board is helping them understand they can be part of something that's bigger than themselves. Let me tell you, there's nothing bigger than yourself in God's kingdom. That is the biggest thing out there. All right, it's nice to be part of the corporation, nice to be part of the company, nice to be part of the organization, but hey, the big deal is it's not where you're working. It's nice, and you should support because they support you, but the big kingdom is the big picture. That we're a part of that, and we're excited about that, and we're moving towards that. And when we understand that, it's amazing. Jesus talking to the disciples again a little later in this chapter, in verse 32, he says, listen, your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things. Well, what's the key to get him? Seek first the kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. All right? I have needs. How am I going to get my needs met? Your kingdom come. Your kingdom come in me. 1 Thessalonians 2:12, the apostle writes to the church of Thessalonica, he says, that you should walk worthy in a manner, worthy of God's call, who calls you into his own kingdom. He's called you into his own glory. That's part of praying, is my commitment. Not only am I praying for the kingdom to literally be established, praying for people to come into the kingdom in the process of it being established, but me being an example as a child of the king, of his kingdom, and serving him, committing my heart solely to him. It's a prayer of personal submission, I believe, for the rule of God over my, Lord, let your kingdom come today. I recognize you as the Lord of my life. I recognize you as the one completely in charge. Your ultimate rule is simply a matter of time, but you can have rule here today. And it's just a matter of time. He is going to come, and he is going to establish his kingdom. Now, there's nothing, I don't care what you get excited about or pumped about, there's still nothing more exciting than that. Heaven in the real world. I think that's exactly what the Apostle Paul was saying. We live from glory unto glory. We experience the glory of God in our life, yeah, but man, we're headed for the glory. It's glorious on the way to glory, but glory, it can be manifest in your life. This kingdom focus, all right? It's a different way of living. It's the way that Jesus lived his life. It's everything about Jesus. Just preach the kingdom. If you took a good life, a good look at the life of Jesus, it becomes a real clear. I mean, in our culture and Christianity, we think of, you know, there's this line between the sacred and the secular. You know, and I got to kind of balance the sacred with the secular and all this stuff. Not with Jesus. It was all about the sacred. It's all about God's will. He said, the things that I'm doing, he said, this is not me doing, it's the Father doing. I'm just finding what the Father wants, and I do that. He said, when you hear me speak, the words that I speak, he said, it's just the words the Father's telling me to speak. He said, the miracles I perform, I don't do those. The Father does them. I said, he didn't have any trouble with that. The disciples, here's Jesus operating the kingdom. Of course, the disciples weren't getting it. All right? They're running around chewing the kids away. Don't bother Jesus. You know, he hadn't got time telling the adults, you know, he's busy now. He's tired. The Lord's tired. Jesus just kept, the other man, bring him to me. Suffer, little children. Such is the kingdom of heaven. Listen. Disciples get all wrapped up and stressed out. They'd sit there and they'd serve bread to 1,000 people, created from a loaf of bread, from one fish or two fish, whatever many it was. It's just a few. And this miracle happens where 5,000 are fed. And the next minute, they're on the boat crossing across the Sea of Galilee and said, I don't think we have enough food to eat. That's like us, isn't it? What are you worried about today? What's troubling you? Your Father knows that you have need of these things. Well, why didn't you do it? Seek your first kingdom of God. It'll be added to you. Get your priorities straightened out. Realize that there's no distinction between the sacred and the secular. The sacred just pours into the secular life. You just understand, hey, this situation, this stress, this trial, this problem, maybe God's wanting to do something right here in this. Maybe God's wanting to teach me something. Maybe God's wanting to teach somebody else with my life. Whatever it is. Why am I freaking out? If God's sovereign over all things and I'm praying for his kingdom to come, I mean, it's just, I'm just part of God's will. No matter what I do this week, it should have kingdom implications. You understand? If I'm getting gas, well, that's nice to eat. I need gas in my car, all right? I got to get some gas, but there should be some kingdom implications while I'm pumping. Maybe someone's there. Maybe no one's there. I can leave a card. I can leave a witness, you know. It's part of your going, where you're going. Just your kingdom come. That's the mindset. You're watching. You're looking. You're expecting. There's an anticipation. I think it's his attitude. As I'm praying, Lord, thy kingdom is saying, Lord, show me today. You know, where I can just live under the rule of your direction and be used by you in a kingdom way to make a difference in the world around you. And by the way, as we do that, and many of you know this by experience, the more that you seek his kingdom, the less you worry about yours. It seems to just erase the worry. And by the way, life becomes a whole lot more exciting. It becomes a whole lot more joyous because the kingdom is here and the kingdom is coming. And you get to be an active part of it while it's on the way. So in prayer, it's intercession. It's for those who don't know Christ become part of the kingdom. It's about not just conversion, but it's also about commitment. How can I be part of the kingdom of God? But understand this, ultimately, the third part and the last part of this message is the full part of this. The call for the kingdom to come is ultimately related to the second coming of Jesus Christ. All right? Yes, he who testifies these things says, I am coming quickly. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. Amen means so be it. In my common vernacular, let it be. All right? Now, I don't think that's what the Beatles were thinking about when they sang, let it be, but it's what God's going to make it happen. Let it be, let it be, let it be, Jesus. Come today. Come quickly. Do your work. Show yourself mighty. Let this be the day you appear in the heavens above us. John says that in the last chapter of the book of Revelation. He's closing out a whole letter. Because in that day, all prayers will finally be answered. So as we're reading scriptures and you start looking even at the New Testament, Paul begins to emphasize that we should be waiting for a kingdom. We should be waiting for this kingdom, not just as it's manifest in our life, yes, but as it's going to finally come. And we should be looking not so much for the event, but the stress in the New Testament is not for the kingdom. It's more upon the emphasis upon the king. We're looking for the king to come and establish himself. 1 Thessalonians 1:10 says, we should wait for his son from heaven, whom he has raised from the dead. That is Jesus, in case you didn't know. It is Jesus who rescues us from the wrath to come. There's coming a day of great deliverance for the family of God and for the people of God. Now, we've talked about this a lot in length, and I feel like I should preach on the second coming at least once a year, and sometimes a series each year. Sometimes I'll do 7 or 8 parts. Sometimes we'll do 2 or 3 in the years, because it's important for us to remember this, because this is the heartbeat of the gospel message. It's not just get saved, get to heaven, all right? It's get saved, one day be a part of the eternal kingdom heaven, but having heaven where you are right now as the kingdom is being established through your life. But there is a day coming which we should be waiting for, thinking about, anticipating, that the same Jesus that God raised from the dead. Wasn't that the final word when Jesus is ascending into heaven? The disciples are all sitting there looking. So an angel comes. What are you boys doing? Why are you standing there staring at the sky? He's going to come again. Get to work. Get to work. That's the idea. It's like one eye on the fields that are white to harvest and the other eye on the kingdom of God and the coming king. And we're celebrating that in our hearts because we know what's coming down the pike. We know what's going to happen. We know where this is all headed. I mean, amen. If you look at it from just a physical perspective, I'll agree with the old saying, this thing's going to hell in a handbasket. Quick. Amen? Well, I don't know about bringing my kids up in this next age. Hey, they may get to see Jesus come if you don't. Hallelujah. They may be the ones who celebrate, and if we're, the Lord takes us before then. But you raise them as kingdom kids with a mindset and a love for Jesus and love for the kingdom. And they become the salt and the light. That's why you're a parent, by the way. All right? For God took his child and put him in your hands for the time being. He's going to take him back sooner or later. But for now, he's letting you raise them. But they're his. Don't be afraid. Jesus is coming in all his glory and all his power. You know, the Bible tells us it's twofold, all right? That's where a lot of times people look at scripture. It's like all those prophecies concerning Jesus, and there were many in the Old Testament concerning a Messiah who would come, all right? And he'd be a savior, and he'd be a king, but he'd also be a lamb. And there was this, they couldn't make this distinction as it made so clear in Isaiah between a king and a lamb in other parts of the Old Testament. They didn't put all the pieces together. But hey, hindsight's 20/20, right? Now you can see what happened and take the scriptures and have more clarity and understanding. The fact is that Jesus comes, and by the way, it's prophesied that he would come, and he fulfilled every prophecy. All those dozens, probably 100 plus prophecies about how he'd be born, where he'd be born, where he'd live, what he'd do, you know, how he would die, you know, what he would say when he died. I mean, all that's on there. He'd be pierced with his ear, not bone be broken. All that's Old Testament prophecy. Jesus chalked off every Old Testament prophecy through his life. Now, that's a miracle. It's impossible for anybody to do that but Jesus. But let me tell you. We know by record, hindsight's 20/20, we look back and say, he fulfilled every prophecy. Wow. Well, what about all these prophecies about what he's going to do next? He's going to fulfill all those prophecies. You say, well, how do you know? He did those. Hindsight's 20/20. Take a look, stupid. Excuse me. Take a look. If he did all those things like he said he would, don't you think he's going to do all the next things like he said he would do it? I mean, there's a pretty good track record back here. So you follow the track record, it should lead us to faith. Well, that's not a whole lot of faith to know, because he did that, he can do that. Amen. That's mustard seed faith, amen? That's a simple choice to make. But he's coming. Now, we know in this New Testament sense, this description of the second coming is really this twofold. A lot of people talk about the rapture, the second coming. They're two different events, okay? Don't confuse that. Second coming is when Jesus comes and sets up the kingdom. The rapture is when he comes and takes his church off the planet because there's getting ready to be 7 years of hell on earth. All right? And that's why it said Jesus will rescue us from the wrath to come. That wrath to come is talking about tribulation, the time of Jacob's troubles. Some people believe that's the last 3.5 years. The kind of the mindset is we get raptured in the middle. Some believe it's the first of 7 years, which I'm more of a component of the 7 years. If I miss some wrath, might as well miss all wrath. Some people think that the second half of the tribulation is going to be worse. Well, it is. But look at the first half is still tribulation. Massive amounts of people, a third of the population or more dying on the planet. I mean, massive disease everywhere. Rivers, it's miserable. All right? So as the wrath is coming, God takes us off. Paul said, we'll see him in the air, right? And we'll be made like him. But that's not the second coming. That's that moment when everybody you know and love that has gone on to be with Jesus, you know, they're going to come with the Lord in the air. Doesn't say they come to the planet. They stop by the planet. All right? And the trumpet sounds, and all the dead in Christ rise from the dead. Their bodies. Now, their soul is with the Lord. So what happens? Soul and spirit join this new incorruptible body. All right? Well, that's crazy. Yeah, but so was the resurrection. And it was just a simple picture of the big resurrection. And he, the one in the simple resurrection, I am the resurrection. So that when I speak the resurrection word, all those in Christ will come forth. But not only that, it says, then we which remain will also be caught up in the air, not on the planet, in the air of the Lord. Now what happens at the end of 7 years when the tribulation is wrapping up, all the enemies of God are moving against, it's just madness that the world's going nuts by this point. Antichrist is reigning. He hates God and Jesus. He's going to actually go to war. How dumb is that? The Bible says Jesus appears in the air with all the saints. We're coming back, all right? In the air with the saints. A sword goes out of his, two-edged sword goes out of his mouth. That means his word is spoken. I don't know what, it may be like drop dead or something, and the Antichrist drops dead. And the devil is in prison for 1,000 years. 1,000 years, Jesus sets up his millennial reign. This is what we're talking about, that 1,000-year reign when Christ comes. And don't worry, you're not going to die out during that time, right? You're an eternal being. Now, once the rapture takes place, this incorruption takes place, and is set aside, and we become incorruptible, all right, the corruption is set aside, we become eternal beings with the Lord Jesus Christ. Listen to these words. The band can start coming about now if you want to. In 1 Timothy 4:7, it says this, I have fought the good fight. This is Paul at the end of his life. I finished the course. I've kept the faith. In the future, there's laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day. And not only to me, but all who love his appearing. What's he saying? If you are waiting, anticipating, and expecting the Lord's appearance, hey, there's a crown waiting for you. How do you know if you really love the Lord's appearing? Your life is being changed. Listen to 1 John. It's not on the screen, but chapter 3. You ought to memorize these verses. And when he says, hey, see how great love the Father has bestowed upon us that we should be called the children of God? Now, it does not yet appear, you know, what we will be, but we know that when he appears, we'll be like him, just as he is. And everyone that has this hope in himself, what, this hope of seeing Jesus and being made pure, those people who have that hope and expectation will make themselves pure now. What's it mean? You'll start living the right kind of life. You start doing what the Lord's called you to do. Catch this verse in Revelation 22, verse 7. Behold, I'm coming quickly, and blessed is he that hears the words of the prophecy in this book. He says again in chapter 22, verse 12, Behold, I'm coming quickly, and my reward is with me to render to every man according to what he has done. And he closes out the book by letting us know. He who testifies these things says, Yes, I am coming quickly. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. So my prayer life is what? My prayer life is first intercession, worship, and then it's intercession. First is what? It's worship, and then it's intercession. So I encourage you today, folks, let's stand together. You can begin playing anytime. This morning, is your prayer life have as a unique part of it this concept that Jesus has given us? Thy kingdom come. Let your kingdom be established. And it'll manifest itself in several ways. One, we are praying for those who don't know Christ. Two, we're making a commitment of our life to Jesus Christ. And we are becoming more pure in our lives. We're becoming more clean in our life. We're ready for the appearing of the Lord Jesus Christ. And three, an excitement, a faith anticipation that the Lord is about to come again. The only thing that has been restrictive, the Lord coming to this point has been the fact that there were prophecies yet to be fulfilled. Things on God's clock, appointments that still had to be made. And those appointments, like Israel becoming a nation, all those appointments have been checked right off. The next big appointment is that Christ appearing in the air, the rapture appointment, when he takes us off the planet. And after that, we come back with him. 1,000 years in the earth. Unfortunately, even after 1,000 years, there'll be those people who still don't believe. The presence of the king right there, and make a choice against him. The final judgment comes. That millennial kingdom ushers right into the everlasting kingdom. We'll live with the Father, with each other and our family, the family of God, for all eternity. What we do, there's a lot to be discovered. But we're not going to be sitting around doing nothing. Are you ready for that? Is your heart ready for that? Has there been a time when you experienced what we call that conversion moment where you gave your life to Christ? He made you a new man, made you a new woman. If not, what are you hesitating? Seriously, what are you waiting for? The Bible says if you hear his voice, that's the time. So if God's been speaking to your inner person, probably well before a sermon like this, God's been talking. Why don't you start listening? Want to respond to faith? Give your life to Jesus Christ today. Right there where you are, you say, Lord, come into my life. I turn from my old way. I turn to you. I want to follow you. Enter into your kingdom. Maybe you're a Christian, but you know that your life really hasn't been on point with the Lord. What are you waiting for? Respond. God's calling. He's not sitting there with a big bat waiting for you to show up and beat you up across the head with it. The blood of Jesus Christ has already forgiven everything. Everything been done. Get in on board. Enjoy the freedom that's in Christ. Father, as we come to you today, our hearts, our lives, our minds are open to you to do with us as you will. I pray, Father, for those who may not know you in this room today, that this would be the point where they respond in faith to the gospel message. They'd come give their life to you. For those who are Christians who just need to get right, God, may they respond. Come to this altar. Repent and leave. Move forward in their purpose for living. Father, for those who just need prayer today, God, we're here for you to speak to our lives and use our hearts and hands to minister to anyone. It's in Jesus' name. If you want to give your life to Christ today, I want you to come move forward right now as we worship the Lord, as we sing. If you're looking for a church home, this is where the Lord's been leading you. I want you to come out now. Step forward. Let's get going. Let's move with the Lord. Come. But whatever the Lord's saying to you, let's be obedient to the Father.
As I come into your presence, past the gates of praise, into your sanctuary, till we're standing face to face, I look upon your countenance and the fullness of your grace. I can only bow down and say, hey. You are awesome in this place, mighty God. You are awesome in this place, Abba Father. You are worthy of all praise. To you our lives we raise. You are awesome in this place, mighty God. As I come into your presence, past the gates of praise, into your sanctuary, till we're standing face to face, I look upon your countenance and fullness of your grace. I can only bow down and say, hey. You are awesome in this place, mighty God. You are awesome in this place, Abba Father. You are worthy of all praise. To you our lives we raise. You are awesome in this place, mighty God. awesome in this place, mighty God. You are awesome in this place, Abba Father. You are worthy of all praise. To you our lives we raise. You are awesome in this place, mighty God.
Just bow your heads a little bit longer with me, if you wouldn't. As they're playing, just between you and the Lord. Maybe we could just have the same communication the disciples had by saying, Lord, teach us to pray. Lord, really show us what it means to spend time with you. Help us to see the kingdom, the big picture. Forgive us, Lord, when we get so trivial about things that stress us and tear at us, when we could be used in the middle of those things. I pray in the name of Jesus, Lord, you give us clarity and perception. It's in Jesus' precious name we thank you. We believe you. Amen. Somebody say amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. You may be seated. What a mighty God we serve. Amen. Well, I'm glad you didn't hang out with the memorial crowd. You came with the more important memorial crowd today. Glad that you're here to worship with us today. Get on the phone, get those folks that are out and about, and summertime has hit us and moving on. Remind them to come on to church. Amen. If they're out and about and on the road traveling somewhere, flip open their phone or whatever and watch us on Facebook, as folks do each week. So, God's about some really, really awesome things in our church. And I'll be sharing some of the things in the next few weeks as we go ahead, and especially we get into the end of the year, some real challenges that we're going to see God move in and how he's going to bless and how he's going to work, because we're going to be usable and available for him. Aren't you excited? God starts moving people's midst and hearts, so buckle down. It's going to get gooder and gooder. Amen. Praise the Lord. Okay.
Amen. All right. So excited to announce that we are going to be having a men's Bible study. It's King Tony Evans' Kingdom Man. So Ezekiel 22:30 says this: I searched for a man among them who would repair the wall and stand in the gap before me on behalf of the land so that I might not destroy it, but I found no one. Man, we're in it's an exciting time, but man, we don't need to forget who we are. We don't need to forget that God's called us for a purpose. We need to and commit ourselves to God's rule. And so starting June 23rd, during the lift time, the evening lift time at 6 p.m., that's on Sunday, so from June 23rd to July 28th for 6 weeks, we're going to be offering Kingdom Man Tony Evans and his Bible study. The cost is $12. Now, I'm limiting it to 15 men. That's it. Now, there'll be multiple times depending on how this goes, but I encourage you to start praying about it. Yes, it's summer lift time, but being a Christian doesn't stop. Being a man of God doesn't stop. And so I encourage you, men, we don't have many Bible studies, and so this is the one you want to go to because you are the leader of your house, amen? And so don't let that go. Don't let somebody else take that. Don't let your wife and your kids learn that from somewhere else. You're the one that God has appointed to be leader of the household. So claim that, amen? And so be sure to sign up. See Bill Robertson in the back to sign up. He's over here. And again, it's the first 15 men. The cost is $12. Kid camp. Next Sunday is the last day to sign up for the early bird discount. Lift groups, we are on a summer recess. That is starting. Today is Memorial Day. We would usually have this day off anyway. But the summer break starts to, next Sunday, so June 2nd through July 28th. There is no official lift meeting. That's not to say that you can't fellowship. That's not to say that you can't get together and go out to lunch or eat breakfast or whatever you want to do. It's just there's no lift study. Okay, amen? So don't let the next time you talk to your lift leaders be August 4th. Go and visit with them. Take them out to lunch. Take me out to lunch. It doesn't matter. All right. This Wednesday, we are going through Paul's letter to the Romans. Now, I don't know if you've noticed, but a lot of churches have stopped doing Wednesday night, because it's just not cost effective. You have 10, 15 people. It costs more to keep the lights on and AC on. It's just not cost effective. Some churches have pray and goes. Some even don't even have Wednesday night service. But we do. We have a service every Wednesday. And this Wednesday, we're going to be talking about God's inescapable love and how the world will oppose us, the world will accuse us, the world will try to condemn us and try to separate us from God's love. But I remind you of Romans 8:32. He who did not spare his own son but delivered him over to us all, how will he not also with him freely give us all things? Amen? So if God is for us, who could be against us? We're going to be diving deeper into that verse right there on Wednesday night. Be sure to come on Wednesday night. No p.m. services again for Memorial Day. Food pantry, there is plenty of food in there. It's not BOGO, it's POGO. Pick one, get one. We got plenty of food, plenty of dry goods in the kitchen, so go by and get it. Welcome cards, if you're a guest of ours, make sure that you take that welcome card to the welcome center, and our pastor would love the opportunity to meet you, greet you, and put a free gift in your hand. Miss Linda, it is great to see you. Thank you so much for coming. Yo, we've been praying for you, so it's good to see you this morning. Finally, we don't pass a plate around here at Believers Fellowship. We have offering receptacles in the back. There are three ways to give. Of course, you can put in the offering receptacle, mail it in, or you can go online, go to our Give tab on our website. It takes you to PayPal. It does cost it does charge us 3%, so be sure to put that 3% charge on there. On the $100, it's $3 for the 100. So just make sure that you give and honor the Lord as he has honored you. Amen. With that being said, you are dismissed.